Now this morning, I believe you will be so blessed. I want to talk to you about one of God's great mysteries, which is out of death comes life. In Matthew's gospel, there's a remarkable statement of Jesus, which is also found in Luke's gospel, and it's Matthew 11:11. I tell you the truth, of all who have ever lived, none is greater than John the Baptist. Yet even the least person in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he is. John led such a disciplined life, you know that. He never married, never had any children. His ministry was only 6 months. I mean, you know, he was very young when he died. He at 30, I believe. He was so utterly sold out to God that when God called him to do what God called him to do, that the very minute that Jesus showed up, he said, he must increase that I must decrease. Thousands were coming to hear him. I mean, what could there be about us that would make that person greater than John the Baptist? But let's talk about it, okay? It's a little more depth to it than just some little flippant answer. Paul answers that question in Galatians chapter 2. You have to remember that John was the first prophet after the 400 years of silence. I mean, there had been no prophet around. He's the one who said and introduced Jesus. Amen. You know, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. He's the one who says, this is the Messiah, in essence, is what he said to everyone. To thousands he baptized. And then Jesus says, well, the least in the kingdom of heaven, that's me and thee, amen, is greater than John the Baptist. Amen. That says, in this, if you're going to put it all together, that we would be greater than Samuel and Moses and Isaiah and even David, all the folks that he named, that John was greater than, and then he says that we're greater than all of that. So let's look at what was said on one occasion, but let's look at it in three translations. For through the law, I died to the law so that I might live to God. I've been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself up for me. I do not nullify the grace of God, for it is righteousness comes through the law. If that's how it happens, then Christ died needlessly. I'm reading the same one from another translation. For when I tried to keep the law, it condemned me. So I died to the law. I stopped trying to meet all of its requirements so that I might live for God. This is Paul talking. My old self had been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. So I live in this earthly body by trusting in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not treat the grace of God as meaningless. For if keeping the law could make us right with God, then there was no need for Christ to die. For through the law, I died to the law so that I might live to God. My old identity has been co-crucified with Christ and no longer lives. And now the essence of this new life is no longer mine, for the anointed one lives his life through me. This is Paul talking. We live in union as one, me and Jesus. My new life is empowered by the faith of the Son of God, who loves me so much that he gave himself for me, his life into mine. So that is why I don't view God's grace as something peripheral. For if keeping the law could release God's righteousness to us, then Christ would have died for nothing. You know, having Christ in us, we're right. I mean, those of us who are in the kingdom of God, we are born again. John Watton, or was any of the Old Testament saints. We're born again, so we have Christ in us. That puts us ahead of John and ahead of all the Old Testament. It's no longer I that live, that Christ lives in me. But let's just look at what that really means. Let me ask you a question. Do you know the definition of oxymoron? When you look at this, you're going to find it. Let me, and for those of you who may not grasp it, it's a combination of words that have opposite or very different meanings. For example, friendly fire. But Paul gives us an oxymoron in this passage of Galatians. He says, I'm dead, but I live. That's one too. That's one of the great mysteries that we're talking about. See, you have to understand, Paul is writing to a congregation of primary Jewish believers, and he comes and he said, I died to the law. I bet they wanted to make him die right there on the spot. You know, for any Jew to say such a thing would be startling, but for Paul, a former Pharisee, to say such a thing, a man who had been a radical, I mean radical about his Judaism, to say, I died to the law, is shocking and astonishing.
Yes.
How did he say such a thing? I mean, you and I have a hard time saying we died to anything. And yet, in order to live, you cannot live unless you die. Oh, Christ will be in you, but I'm talking about having control. We're talking about, see, you don't really live until you get out of the way. You don't really live. So, here we got the Pharisee of Pharisees, the one who was killing anybody who said they followed Jesus. He said, I found out that the law can't save me. I'm helpless to save myself. I can never be smart enough. I can never be holy enough on my own. I can never have enough strength to be accepted by God in myself. So I died, Paul said, to the law, because I came to Christ when I believed in him, when I realized that his death was my death. That's what's wrong with the church today. They have not recognized this. That's why the world calls the church hypocrites. Because we have not recognized this. He says, I was so truly crucified with Jesus that the life I have now is utterly and completely different. He says, Jesus lives in me. All I am now is just a vessel, he says, for Christ to live through me. The me is gone. He lives on. Man, I want to understand that, don't you? Paul said, I thought that willpower and law-keeping was the way to live, but brothers and sisters, I was so wrong, he said. He's talking to Jews. He says, I was wrong. I was wrong. He said it to the Romans this way in Romans 7. So my dear brothers and sisters, this is the point. You died to the power of the law when you died with Christ. And now you're united with the one who was raised from the dead. As a result, you can produce a harvest of good deeds for God. Now, church, listen. From the moment that you and I are born again, our life is meant to display only Jesus. Church, we're in a time in our lives that we want God to clean out what he can clean out. There are things that you could, the hurdles that you could get past in a second if you let a little humility come in your life. I mean, everything could be changed in a moment. See, but we justify our behavior, which is unchristlike. We justify it. See, Paul gets very personal. He said, I want you to notice, he said, I died, I was crucified, and now Christ lives in me. 5 times in that passage, he used the word I. He made it very personal. You know, he wasn't comparing himself to anybody. He was talking about him and his relationship to the Lord. You know, he makes it so personal, his walk with Jesus. You think that Jesus only died for Paul. I mean, he gets so tuned to it. Do you do realize that Paul had to go to Arabia for 14 years before he came back and was able to be the Paul that you and I know? The Paul who could give us mysteries of the Bible, who could give us insight and revelation. He didn't give it instantaneous. He learned to walk his talk. Amen. Not just speak something he heard for a minute or two. Have you ever made it that personal for you? Have you ever sat quietly and just said, I died? Have you ever just shut up long enough? So Paul makes an issue. He says, because one of the deepest mysteries of God is that life comes out of death. Now, there are three ways, church, that any person can choose to live. I'm talking about how you live your life. Number one, you can live under the law of Moses. So for centuries, the Jews are still doing it. But for centuries, the Jewish people had the opportunity to do what would please God, but they didn't do it. Paul said the law was good. Paul said the law was holy, but it never saved anyone.
That's right.
Do you realize the law, the first five books of the Bible, so to speak, the Torah, that's what that is, first five books of the Bible, never saved anyone? In fact, in Romans 7, Paul said the law nearly killed him. Have you read it and seen it? That's what it's his actual words, basically. It nearly killed me. Listen to me carefully. The law was given as a diagnosis, not as the cure. The law is a spiritual MRI. machine that reveals what's wrong inside of you, but it cannot heal you. The purpose of the Torah, first five books of the Bible, was to reveal man's sinfulness and to give definition to our motives and behaviors, but the Torah was never able to transform our hearts, only to expose our hearts. Number two way. Bargaining with God. I've hopped around on this one a good bit. Bargaining with God. God said to Israel, if you will, I will. Let's look at Exodus 15:26. He said, if you will listen carefully to the voice of the Lord your God and do what is right in his sight, obeying his commands and keeping all his decrees, then I will not make you suffer any of the diseases I sent on the Egyptians, for I am the Lord who heals you. You remember Gideon put out a fleece. He was bargaining with the Lord. Jacob bargained with his brother Esau for the firstborn blessing. How many times have you tried to bargain? The third way, living by the life of Jesus himself within us. See, we human beings have this tendency to prove ourselves to ourselves and to others, and we even try to prove ourselves to God. We so easily measure ourselves by our performance rather than by who we are. Born again, washed in the blood, disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's who you are. I'm nobody outside of him. Christianity, my friend, is not an improved life. It's a new life, altogether new life. God's not after a changed life. He's after an exchanged life. You give me yours, I'll give you mine. That's a pretty good deal. You know, God's intent has never been to improve your ego. His intent is to kill it. And it's placed to deposit Jesus in us so that Jesus can continue. This is the key, so that Jesus can continue to live on the earth. You're it. You're it to your family. You're it to your people you work with. You're it. If you're born again, you're saying Jesus lives in me, and you're supposed to be showing them a Christ-like walk. You're it.
Is guilt keeping you from moving forward with God? Do you want to do right, yet can't seem to make it happen? If you truly desire the things of God, there is a way to be free. In Sandra's 6-CD series, Freedom from Sin's Power, she teaches how to break free from sin's power so you can receive complete freedom and live a victorious life. To order, call 706-737-4530 or log on to sandrakennedy.org. And for a gift of only $35.95, allow Sandra's anointed series to teach you how to break free.
Listen, even the disciples did not change until after they received the Holy Spirit, until after they were born again. Well, the Lord loved them dearly. He lived with them. They did miracles. He even let them do a bunch of miracles under His anointing. They did. They came back and said, wow, even the demons. Wow. We heal people. Look what we did. You don't think when they came back to give their report, they wasn't trying to out-report each other? Come on. You know how you do? They didn't have Christ living in them. They was living with Christ. But He wasn't in them. Are you listening? But did all of that walking with Jesus, talking with Jesus, visiting with Jesus, eating in His house, going with Him, being, you know, His buddy, having set up His ministry and done everything for Him? Preparing the way for Him, going ahead of time. Jesus is coming. He's my friend, you know. Did any of that change them? No. Judas betrayed Him. Peter denied Him, and everybody else left. That's exactly what happened. Look at John 14. But when the Father sends the Advocate as my representative, what Jesus was saying, that is the Holy Spirit, He will teach you everything and will remind you of everything I've told you. Do you realize that the top priority of the Holy Spirit inside of you, His primary mission in you, is to reveal the Christ in you? Period. To transform you so thoroughly that as you go through life, Jesus is able to express Himself through you. Amen. Through your thought, through your words, through your deeds. That's what the Holy Spirit is trying to do for all of us. We've talked a lot about grace, but let me give you another definition of grace. Grace is Christ alive in you, glorifying the Father. Grace is Jesus in you, living life through you. You do realize that the natural you is supposed to be dead. We're talking about the you who was on the throne of your heart. You no longer live. Christ lives in you. Now, I'm going to say something that's probably going to surprise you. Grace is the most difficult way for a human being to live. Why? Because to live by grace, you have to stop saying things like, I've been trying to overcome my anger, but I'm still struggling. That's a law statement. That is not a grace statement. Or I've been trying to be more patient, but I get so easily frustrated. You know what the problem is? I've been trying. He didn't ask you to try. He asked you to die. He never said anything about trying. He said, die, kill that old one in there. Kill that old way of doing things. Kill that rising up monster that comes on you. You know, kill that thing. Stomp it. Keep it down. With my help, when you recognize you got it and give it to me, we can do this thing. You can't do it. Do you understand? That's law talk, honey. And as long as you think you got to keep trying and try and try and try, you're not going to get any victory. As long as you think you can improve yourself, forget it. It's not the way for victory. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. It's about living with a conscious and consistent awareness that the resurrected and eternal Jesus is alive in me. In order for the reason he's alive, in order to extend the living of his life on this earth through me. And therefore, the impulse of the habits of the old life have no place anymore in me. Because I died, I've exchanged my old life for his life. And they're trying to rise up. I feel it rising up. Well, you better get out of that situation some way. See, living by grace is so hard because we are steeped in performance. Legalists bound by a religious spirit that keeps them addicted to performance rather than the saving grace of God will never discover the joy and the peace that Paul says, it's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. Church, from the Father's perspective, the death of Jesus was your death as well. Amen. That's hard to really, get it. But it's the truth. It's the truth. We don't think of death as a benefit. But listen to me. Dying has never been on anybody's bucket list of things to do. I understand that. But it's the heartbeat of God. You know, it's like Jesus saying, both of us can't be in charge in here. When Jesus went to the cross, he just grabbed us all, pulled us to his bosom, and took us there and died, came up out of the grave. We came up with him. We went to the cross, we came up out of the grave with him, now living with him. But you, that old self don't want to let go. Jesus has got to be bigger than the old self. Amen. Whichever one has the most power on the inside is going to be the one that's going to do the most. Amen. Talking and pushing and driving your life. You know that. Colossians 3:3 says, "For you died to this life and your real life is hidden with Christ in God." You have died, that's past tense. Life is hidden, that's present tense. You have immersed yourself in Christ. You exchanged your life for the life of Jesus. When Jesus went to the cross, you were there with him. When Jesus said it's finished, he said Saul of Tarsus was finished. So were you. It's finished, he said. The battle is over. Yes. You just have to acknowledge it, and your duty is to keep it down. Yeah. Your responsibility, always go raise its head, keep it down. Amen. Don't let it take the old place again. Amen. The whole message of the New Testament, the whole Bible, is that you and I could not pay for our sins. Amen. Even if you wanted to, you couldn't. But because of Jesus, I've been acquitted. I've been exonerated. I've been free because of Jesus. That's what justification means. It's the opposite of condemnation. And then God put inside of us every single thing we need. Everything we need. Everything we need to live for him. Everything we need. The old person you were is no more. That's an amazing statement. Everything is new. The very moment you said yes to Jesus, you died to yourself. Amen. And the Lord of glory moved in so he could continue to live his life through you. So that you can truthfully and honestly and experimentally say what Paul said in Galatians 2. For through the law, I died to the law, so that I might live to God. My old identity has been co-crucified with Christ and no longer lives. And now the essence of this new life is no longer mine, for the Anointed One lives His life through me. We live in union as one. My new life is empowered by the faith of the Son of God, who loves me so much that He gave Himself for me, dispensing His life into mine. Is that not wonderful? Y'all, it's wonderful. See, grace has not just improved you. The grace of God has totally and absolutely made you brand new. Look at Romans 6, 6 through 7. We know that our old sinful selves were crucified with Christ so that sin might lose its power in our lives. We are no longer slaves to sin. For when we died with Christ, we were set free from the power of sin. In closing, let me say this. This is why I call this God's Cinderella story. As the girl in the fairy tale was enslaved by the evil stepmother, sin enslaved us until the day we met the prince, the son of the king, who transformed us into royalty, into the kingdom of God. Hallelujah! 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 Exchanged our life for the life of Jesus. Let Him shine through us, church. Shine, Jesus. Shine, 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 Jesus. I'm so grateful for God's overwhelming love and grace, for what He has done for us, in us, and through us. I'm so thankful. I feel like the woman, as I said last week, who came to wash the feet of Jesus when she said, "I may have done what you said I did, but I'm not who you say I am."
Amen.
I've been set free. I'm forgiven. I'm redeemed, and I no longer lives. Christ lives in me. I love it. I may have done what you said I did. I may have, but I want to tell you something. I'm not who you say I am. Glory to God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Praise you, Lord God Almighty.